Hey guys, Amar, and the frame is a little is not proper because my tripod is damaged, so I've ordered a new tripod and it'll come by tomorrow, but I'm trying to see if I can fit properly into the frame and it doesn't look that awkward. Is it fine? Cool. I think it'll look fine. All right, so hey, cool, hope you're doing well. And we are reading. I don't want to miss a day of reading or take a break, because otherwise it loses momentum, right? It's like just to keep momentum, it takes a lot of effort. So I don't want to lose momentum, and so we'll continue reading. We're reading my book, 10 Short Stories for Young Adults, and today the story, we've read three stories already. They're total 10 stories, so it's a series of 10 videos overall. And today the story is on love. The story today is on love. So love is the most illogical and irrational thing to happen to human beings. I mean, I really believe in love. I think love should be the input for a happy life. There's no love in what we do. There's no love in our relationships. There is no happiness. So in fact, I've written an entire book. It's called The Impossible Couple. So we'll also get to that book in some time in this reading series. So then I'll talk about love even more deeply, right? Cool. So love is the most, let me see if I can just move a little better. It's like fine, all right, looking full now, cool, better. So love is the most illogical and irrational thing to happen to human beings. There's hardly anything inexplicable about it. It is experiential, it is spiritual. To talk about love, I'll divide it into four sections. Wow, this is gonna be a little long. Loving a parent. Do you understand your parents? I don't. Wow. I think I'm one of the craziest children anyone could have. There's one thing I know, and I know it very, very well. My parents will stand by me whenever something untoward happens. They always have, and I know they will even now. I think that love is a verb. I know my parents love me. I have faced some extremely difficult times during my growing up years. All them far from being a grown up even now. I refuse to grow up. I guess things don't change. It's optional anyways. Whenever things got up, they stood by me, and I felt guilty inside, feeling that they should not. There were times when I felt I did not deserve their love, and why should they bother? But they did. Maybe I do not understand this right now because I'm not a father, but it's insane love. I consider myself a messenger of logic. Wow. More of happiness. I respect reason and fail to understand the lack of it. I've given up my efforts to find anything rational about love. I bore the love of my parents and love. I completely, absolutely despise people who have no respect for their parents, condemn them in totality. I've known people in my environment who have given no respect to their parents in their twilight years and treated them in shocking ways. I think these people deserve nothing. I understand that we will have thought level differences. Well, definitely. Since the world has evolved drastically in the last 15 years, if people like me have grown up in these times, tend to think differently. But that by no ways means that you throw your parents out of their own homes and let them die alone somewhere in obscurity. Let me tell you a small story. Prasad was born in Delhi, India. He was the only child of his parents and was born after 5 years of his parents' married life. They prayed at many temples for a child and had felt their prayers had been answered when Prasad was born. His father used to work as a clerk with the Indian government and did not make a lot of money. He has been an honest and sincere man. His mother supported the family financially by giving tuitions to primary school children. His parents worked very hard to make ends meet in an expensive city like Delhi and made sure that their son got the best of education and became a successful man. That had been their only ambition from their dull and monotonous life. I see no reason why people should have dull and monotonous life for their kids though. I think they themselves should be their top priority. Otherwise, it becomes a bit of burden on the children that the parents sacrifice their lives to them. Parents are good at Prasad was good at studies and was an avid cricketer also. He won many tournaments for the school. His parents always supported him and never made him get a sense of financial troubles they went through. They had a tough time arranging for the school fee and training fee for the cricket academy, but somehow they managed it. They're very proud of their son and happy that he'd been progressing well in life. Prasad's achievements were known to everyone they know. Their jobs had no only means of their end and find money to educate their only child. It did not mean anything more. Prasad grew up to be a manager with a multinational firm. He had just finished his MBA and was hired from the campus. parents were elated. His mother would go around telling anyone how happy she was for her son, and his father allowed himself a tad of arrogance. They felt their efforts had paid off and all the pain had been relieved. Prasad's father organized a party and invited his family and friends to celebrate the success of the son. "Today I feel at the top of the world, Prasad. I'm so happy that you've done a sprout. Although I was confident about you, but there were sometimes when I had insecurities about your future. All the doubts have melted away today and you have not let us down. I'm sure your mother is also elated beyond measure today. Although she'll not say much. Well done, my boy," Prasad's father said to him at the end of the party. "Thank you, Papa. I'm also very happy and things have worked so positively." He said nothing else that would please his parents on this important occasion. Prasad had fallen in love with a girl during his MBA and now he wanted to marry her. He shared this thought with his father. The girl was not from the same caste, which is generally a very important matter in Indian households. His parents, although apprehensive of the idea, relented since the issue at stake was Prasad's happiness and they could not be dogmatic. The girl's family was very pleased with Prasad and his success and had no problems with the marriage. The marriage was decided and Prasad got married within months. The girl's family was fairly rich and gave a handsome dowry, although Prasad's family did not ask for any. "We're giving everything for our daughter itself, and after all, Prasad is our son also," the girl's mother insisted. Prasad's wife Rachna was an attractive girl, or at least Prasad thought so. She had married Prasad because she fell in love with him and they spent a lot of time doing the MBA to study each other as well. However, she came from a richer family. She found it difficult to adjust to Prasad's house. She was also working and decided she would not spend any of her time doing housework or of any sort. Prasad's father had retired by now and spent a lot of time reading and sleeping. His mother had stopped giving tuition 5 years back. She now spent more of time in attending to the house. She felt that they had worked enough for the whole of their lives. Now it was their time to rest. They had no idea life was going to be even more difficult for them. Prasad's started spending most of his time in office and would come home irritated to sleep. Rachna had similar behavior with rudeness attached to it. They started feeling extremely angry about it and faced it for a few months, and it almost became almost expected. Then one day Prasad's father decided to confront him and try to understand what was happening. "Prasad, this is not what we have expected. You have no time for us at all, and Rachna is even rude to us. What are we to do and what have we done to deserve this?" "Papa, it's none of Rachna's fault. Please do not say anything to her. She comes back home so tired every day. And then she has to listen to you and mommy. What is she expected to do?" There are long arguments which caused immense pain to Prasad's father. They stopped complaining, but the status quo remained. Suddenly one day Prasad came to tell his father that he and his wife have had enough of the chaos and had decided to move on. Prasad's mother started crying, could not stop herself. She was a shy lady and did not have the courage to say anything to her grown-up son anymore. Perhaps she just did not expect anything from him anymore. They knew that Rachna was the reason for what was happening and she had triggered this decision. But they were not angry with Rachna. They were angry and disappointed with their son for not being able to stand by them. They left. Prasad's parents lived alone. Prasad had not visited them even after leaving. End of story. That's a painful story. But again, at the same time, it's not that a lot of people in this generation are bad towards their parents. Most kids are nice to their parents. Most people I know, they are loving to their parents. But this is one story, which is one side of the story. End of the story. There are many similarities in the story to the world we live in. They are. We are what we are because of the sacrifice and love of our parents. They may have been skeptical at times, and their ways may be different, but I can say this with certainty that our parents could have never thought ill of us in their wildest dreams. Love your parents and be grateful for their love and presence. Do not take them for granted. When you were growing up, they made sure that you were cared for. When they go down, they'll need us the most. Mother's Day. Mawar's was perhaps the word. There's a poem on Mother's Day. "Mawar's perhaps the first word I learned to say. She's seen me since I grew. I never saw her shirking her duties in any way. The most inexplicable relation in the world, the deepest in every state, every layer. Nothing I could do would diminish her love that could take away her care. I'm not sure how good a son I've been. She's been selfless, loving and keen. She would sit in front of me just looking at me as I finished my food. She'd do all to make sure I came to say to the world, I am doing good." The relation between a mother and a child will always be sacred. A mother's love would love and protect her child even if he is the greatest idiot. There's so many relations in this world, so brittle, so fragile. But one relation which you can always be certain of is that of a mother of a child. One person, I'm sure, would always be happy to see me. One person I'm sure would always love me. One person I'm sure would always wait for me. One person I'm sure would tell the world of my achievements. One person I want to make really proud is my mom. Is my mother. I hope it's the same for you. Cool. So there's a second part of this chapter. Give me. I'll take a sip of water. This is a long chapter, right? This is the parts of this chapter on love, on different kinds of love. Let's see. Let's do at least one more section. If there are more parts which I don't remember, because I wrote this book a long time back, we'll do tomorrow. Cool. Let's do loving your partner, right? Love will not always last. Be thankful that it happened. I feel sorry for people who have never been courageous enough to feel the feel of love. Take a risk. There's nothing more beautiful to life. Falling in love is the gooeyest, tickling and ethereal feelings one can experience. That's nice. Falling in love is the gooeyest, tickling and ethereal feelings one can experience. There have been a few days in my life that I've never been able to forget. One such day was when I said I love you for the first time in my life. I could not bear the exhilaration of that feeling, of having been able to express that. I loved it then. I love it now whenever the thought of it comes to my mind. I meant it. Became a different person since that day. It's extremely difficult to explain the rush in our veins and cells when you fall in love with someone who falls in love with you. You've got to feel it. You have to face it or miss living the best life has to offer. The problem with love is that it may not last forever, even till the end of your life. You've got to be mature enough to be able to handle it. It's killing and extremely painful if you're an emotional person and have little control over your emotions. But you learn if you're willing to learn. Sometimes things come to an end and they're never the same again. It pains because it is the end of something very beautiful. Some things that money can't buy, for everything else, is a MasterCard. Let me tell you a love story. Peter finished his schooling in Manipur and came to Delhi for his graduation. He rented a room near the university and started an important chapter in his life. He was an excellent student in his state and scored over 90% marks in his 10 plus 2 examinations, and hence was admitted to a top college in the University of Delhi, one of the best universities in the country. His father was a doctor in Manipur and accepted his desire to go to the capital for further studies. He chose a program in commerce, honors, since there was an apparent demand for it at the end of the program in the job market. He had not taken up science because it did not interest him, and hence he could not become a doctor, which he knew would have pleased his father. It was his first day in college and he went there in the best clothing he had with him. He knew he needed to buy some new clothes. I shall do that later, maybe at the end of the first week, he reminded himself. Come here, Chinky. That's racism in Delhi, a boy remarked, pointing towards him. Chinky was the slang used to address people from Northeast in Delhi, he learned later. He also learned that it was rather used contemptuously. The boy who called him was a senior, they wanted to rag him. But as he was walking towards him, a teacher passed by and the boys ran away. He was saved from the trouble. He attended all the lectures scheduled and took his copy of the timetable. He made some acquaintances and met his classmates. He only liked one person out of all the people he met that day. Hi, my name is Deepthi. I'm from West Delhi. My name is Peter. I'm from Manipur. Life went on. He was doing well in studies and also participated in many extracurricular activities. He would play the guitar that he brought from Manipur and participate in inter-college competitions. He won many awards. Since he was popular, he made friends with many people. They would visit his room sometimes at the end of the classes. He realized one day he had been thinking about Deepthi very often. And where had she been? Deepthi seemed only interested in studies and nothing else. She had round eyes, oval face and gleaming skin. She walked with grace and poise. Everything about her was charming. Peter decided he will find a way to talk to Deepthi. The next day, at the end of the class, he approached. Hi, Deepthi. Hi, Peter. How are you? I'm fine, thanks. How are you? I'm fine also. Deepthi, would you like to share your notes with me? Peter had completely lost it. This is not what it wanted to say. The exams are approaching and Deepthi said she had no problems in sharing her notes with him. He took her notes and smelled them all night. Peter would call his home as often as he could, generally a few times during the year. He told his father that there was no need to worry about the first year examinations and that he had prepared well. The exams lasted for a couple of weeks and Peter did not get any opportunity to talk to Deepthi. Deepthi fared the best in the examinations. In fact, everyone had known how sincere she had been about studying. That was the only thing she was serious about. She did not seem to pay attention to anything else. She did have friends, but they were also studious and bookworm type. People who had no other interest besides academics. Now Peter had had enough and he was going to talk to Deepthi this time. It was the end of the last session on the first day after exams. He approached. Hi Deepthi. Hi Peter. Your notes are really helpful to me. You're welcome. Deepthi said. Deepthi, do you think you'd have some time to have coffee with me? Well, okay. I need to leave for home now. Can we do another day? Yes, absolutely. Do you think Friday might be a good day? Okay. So Deepthi left. Peter could not contain his enthusiasm. He felt something happening in his mind. Sensations within his body that told him that what he just did was a very important one. And he was happy that he pulled it off. He never asked anyone out for coffee before. That is why this is important. This is Monday and the coffee meeting was on the Friday. He felt that Friday is years ahead. He got restless and started praying that Friday should come as soon as possible. He attended the lectures, but he was elsewhere in his mind. His eyes kept moving to Deepthi over and over again. He moved them to the professor. They came back to Deepthi. Friday came. They had agreed to meet in a coffee house near their college after the classes. He reached first and waited. He believed this was the rule of courtesy for the boy to wait for the girl. She arrived 15 minutes late. He smiled at her. She smiled at him. She was wearing a black jacket and a jeans. She was adorned beautifully in a salwar. He was wearing a black jacket and jeans. She was adorned beautifully in a salwar suit in pink color. She looked magnificent, he thought. Deepthi, you look very nice. Thanks, she said. I want to get to know you, Deepthi, if you will allow me. What would you like to know about me? About your life, likes, dislikes, thoughts, dreams. Deepthi gave it. I'm a simple traditional girl from a conservative family. I do not think that much. What about you? They started talking, kept on talking. By the end of the meeting, they felt very comfortable with each other. Peter was ecstatic and felt on top of the world. They started meeting often and even studying together. It was evident to each other that they were growing fond of each other. They did nothing to avoid the feeling. Peter introduced Deepthi to his friends and she started opening up and became more talkative. Peter also learned to spend time with bookworms. When they thought about each other, they felt this was the most beautiful thing to happen to them. When Peter thought about her, he felt she was the prettiest creature on earth. Nothing could have ever matched her beauty. He was so lucky to have her as a part of his life. Peter is such a wonderful person. It must be beautiful. Since he says so. I'm so lucky to have her, thought Deepthi. Thoughts of future were consciously avoided. All they had wanted was to enjoy each other's presence and love. They did not even realize that the professor announced, "You will have a final examination next month and then your college life will be over. You will soon step into the real world. It will not be easy." How did time fly by? Why was time always rushing? What a heartless, cruel thing it is. That evening when they met, Peter sat in front of Deepthi and stared at her. Within minutes, he had tears in his eyes. Deepthi started crying too. "I do not want to lose you, Deepthi. Why did we never speak about it? I love you," he said. This was the first time it said this. Deepthi started crying even more. He hugged her. They kept crying in each other's arms for a long time. She sobbed, "I love you too, Peter. I love you too. We will always be together." They consoled each other. College life soon came to an end. Both of them got jobs and started working. It made things difficult for them as they were not being able to spend any time with each other. They decided that they'll close their relationship with their families. They did. And what happened wasn't pretty. Deepthi's parents were shocked. They could not believe that their daughter could have found a man for herself. "How can I marry my daughter from a boy called Peter?" her mother exclaimed and fainted. She had to be taken to a hospital and administered blood glucose. She did not even take the time to express what she exactly felt about it. "Deepthi, we did not expect this," her father said, confused about the appropriate behavior in such a situation. Deepthi did not say anything till her mother returned. She had no idea what was happening. One thing she knew was that she loved Peter, and there was no conceivable reason in her mind why she should not get married to him. She did not understand the reaction of her parents. What did her father mean by "we did not expect this"? What exactly did he expect? She had known that hers was a conservative family, but she also knew that Peter was a great guy, intelligent, talented, and most importantly, he loved and cared for her. Nothing else was important in her mind. She wanted to make it work. When her mother recovered and came back to her senses, the discussion resumed. "What does he do?" "He works with Infinity Delbert Company. We studied together." "So that's what he studied, I see. Does he belong to our caste?" her father asked. "Papa, I have no clue. I do not understand all this. I know you would have liked to find a Punjabi boy for me, but then I did not find one. I like Peter and he likes me. Isn't that enough for you? I'll be happy with him." Her parents looked disappointed. "This cannot be done. We'll find another boy for you. Someone rich and who belongs to our caste and culture." "No, please. Money is not the point. I want someone who takes care of me, someone I like, and he's Peter." There are long series of arguments. They tried to blackmail her in many ways, but somehow Deepthi did not relent. She was determined to succeed. Eventually, her parents agreed to meet Peter. He spoke very respectfully to them because they learned to be respectful to other elders, and also because he was meeting with these parents. The meeting meant a lot to him. They invited him over for dinner. It was a big opportunity to prove he was the right boy for their daughter. "What do your parents do?" asked Dipti's father of Peter. "My father is a doctor, my mother is a housewife." "How long have you been in Delhi?" "I came here for my graduation. Now it has become home for me. I got a job after college and now I live. The job market in Delhi is better than in Manipur. And since I could not become a doctor, I cannot continue my father's practice in Manipur." "You like Dipti?" Dipti's mother asked. Dipti was looking at him at this point in time. This is beautiful, no? Dipti was looking at him at this time with dreams in her eyes. How badly she wanted this meeting to succeed. How badly had she wanted that Peter will be liked for the family. Peter said, "I like her more than anything else. More than anything I've ever liked. She means the world to me. I'll do everything it takes to keep her happy." I know that as parents you must have had a picture of a boy in your mind for Dipti. Maybe I do not look any close to that, but I assure you that I'll do everything possible to keep her happy. Dipti had tears in her eyes. By now, she started sobbing, and girls do not know what to do. They cry. No one knew what to do. Poor Peter could not go and hold her. The meeting ended very positively, and Dipti's mother allowed her to go and drop Peter in the room. Dipti could not describe the happiness. She looked at her parents' faces and sensed approval. She cried some more and hugged them. Peter's family did not have objections. They felt grateful that Peter had found himself a wonderful girl and enriched their life also. Peter and Dipti would be married within a year. End of story. Oh wow. End of story. What a beautiful story that was. Wow. Cool. So love. Something that love is blind. Something it just happens. Something it is a decision. Something it is hard to find no matter what it is true. It only happens to a select few. No, I think it happens to everyone. It's just that people are not courageous enough to accept love. There's none who does not sense the feelings of high. The ones in love are those who do not let it die. We have one life to live, only one to love as well. One life to hold that hand. One life to feel that smell. One life to look in those eyes. One life to jump to those vibes. One life to sleep in the warmth of that lap. One life to get close and kill that gap. One life to feel the blood rushing. One life to sense the heart hushing. One life to be with that special someone. One life that cannot be undone. One life to take that risk to say it all. One life to be everything or nothing at all. I wish everyone reading this gets to feel what they call love. This is life. This is it. And there's nothing so beautiful. Cool. There's another part of the... Cool. There's another part of the... Of the chapter love. It's called An Old Woman on the Street. I think this is about, yeah, we'll do this. This is about love for strangers. The four sections we did love for parents, we did love for love towards your partner, and this is the third part, An Old Woman on the Street. I saw an old woman today, alone, abandoned. She had a stick in her right hand and a small bag in her left. Her face was wrinkled and her eyes, her body were completely worn out. She was walking slowly, looking here and there so nobody hits her because she was just so frangible. Her hair was completely white and her body thin and weak. She looked left and she looked right. Her step could not be more than 4 inches at a time. She was wearing a faded dress which bore complete semblance to her body. I looked at her for 5 minutes while she moved slowly, trying to save herself from the world. She used to be an attractive part of a few years back. She must have been a 16-year-old girl once upon a time in her life, and boys would have fancied her. She may have been a mother for most of her life, nurtured and cared for her children like us. She would have been a wife and had a husband, who may not be in this world anymore. She would have been a part of this world, and then the world would have not noticed her. I could do nothing to help to improve her life. But today she was alone. Alone and scared. The world passed by and no one cared. Everyone was so busy and involved in their lives that they did not care to even notice her presence. She just does not exist anymore. Nobody needs it. I looked at her for 10 minutes and kept looking till she reached the end of the road and disappeared. My eyes were moist, and they are moist even now, thought of. Please do not let anyone meet the fate of the old woman. Do not let people, let our people feel that they do not exist. Then they do. Okay, cool. So we've finished the chapter on love. It's a beautiful chapter. It was a beautiful chapter. Although, I'll just say, my writing now is much better than it was then. But I think the stories on love for parents, the story on love between Peter and Peter and his girlfriend. I forgot her name now. They're beautiful. I think it was a beautiful story. And the reason I put the story about the old woman is that we should feel love for strangers and should care for them as much as possible. Love is everything there is. I generally tend to say that when love is the ingredient, happiness is the output. Alright, thank you. Well, we've done 4 stories in this book. We have 6 more to go. And after that, I think I'll decide. Maybe I'll read the book for kids, the poetry book that I wrote for kids. I'm looking forward to that. Yeah. Stay subscribed. I hope you're enjoying the reading sessions, and I hope they make you happy.